Hello students, welcome back to the second part of Alpha Decay. So in this session we'll be learning about the Gammon's theory of Alpha Decay. So before getting into the actual concept, let us recall the theory of Alpha Decay. So that is whenever we have an nucleus, okay, which is having an atomic number, sorry, mass number which is greater than 200. So these type of nucleus will be emitting alpha decay. So due to the larger size, so in order to gain stability, so these nucleus undergo alpha decay. So now this is what we call it as the parent nucleus, and when this undergoes alpha decay, the newly formed daughter nucleus will be having its atomic number less by 2 units and mass number less by 4 units, and along with the emission of the alpha particle, which is nothing but identified as the helium nucleus. And we all know that the maximum kinetic, that is the range of kinetic energy of the alpha particle that is been emitted during alpha decay, will be around 4 mega electron volt to 9 mega electron volt. So this is the range, or approximately 10 mega electron volt. So this is the range of the alpha particle that is being emitted and which is measured experimentally. Now in this nucleus, that is inside this parent nucleus, so we have what to say, that we have the nucleons, so which is nothing but protons, that is plus neutrons, which are combinedly called as the nucleons. So inside this nucleus we have a force, that is what we call it as a nuclear force, which is attractive when the distance between any two nucleons is in between, that is between two Fermi, that is two Fermi means it is 10 to the power of minus 15 meter. So within this range, the nuclear force will be attractive. So beyond this distance, that is if the distance between any two nucleons increases than 2 Fermi, then the nuclear force goes on decreasing. That is the intensity of the nuclear force decreases. And if the distance between any two protons or nucleons, if it is greater than 4 Fermi, that is 4 into 10 to the power of minus 15 meter, the nuclear force will be negligible. So we are seeing that there is those parent nucleus whose mass number is greater than 200. So these are said to be big size nucleus. Okay, so here what happens, the nuclear force is little bit less dominant and than that of the Coulomb force. Why? Because the size of the nucleus is a little bit large, and nuclear force will be little bit negligible if the distance between any two nucleons is greater than 2 Fermi, then the nuclear force goes on decreasing. At this particular point, if the distance between any two nucleons is less than 2 Fermi, then it is, that is, the nuclear force is dominant. Beyond this, the nuclear force goes on decreases. So therefore, the Coulomb force will be more predominant than that of the nuclear force. Reason, students, once again, here we are saying that is alpha decay is possible only in the case of the nucleus or radioactive nucleus whose mass number is 200. So mass number means it is nothing but the total number of protons and neutrons, right? So when the size of this nucleus is greater than 200, we say that it is a bigger nucleus. So in a bigger nucleus, as the size of the nucleus goes on increasing, the nuclear force between the nucleons, okay, goes on decreasing. Why? Because the nuclear force is a short range force. So due to this property of the nuclear force, so beyond this distance, so the nuclear force goes on decreases, and the Coulomb force, okay, so will dominate than that of the nuclear force. So beyond this distance, the nuclear force is completely negligible. So therefore, we have the Coulomb force more predominant than that of the nuclear force beyond the distance between any two nucleons greater than this distance. So we know the structure of alpha particle. That is, it consists of two protons and two neutrons. That is, if we see the structure of the alpha particle that is being emitted by any heavy nucleus, So it appears as a discrete particle. Remember students, that is, if you observe the alpha particle which is coming out of any parent, that is the parent nucleus during alpha decay, if you observe the structure of the alpha particle, it is consisting of the two protons and two neutrons. So that is, we can say that there is the emission of alpha particle by any heavy parent nucleus appears as a discrete particle. So this makes us to assume there is a tightly bound system of two protons and two neutrons will be pre-existing inside this parent nucleus. That is, if you observe the structure of the alpha particle, that is, we can see that there are two protons because the charge number, that is the atomic number, is Z, it is equal to 2, and mass number, and if you calculate the number of neutrons, it will be equal to 2. Okay, so therefore it is consisting, or it is a structure, or it is a tightly bound system of two protons and two neutrons to pre-exist inside the nucleus of a parent nucleus, or we can say that this alpha particle structure is a substructure of the parent nucleus. So let us consider this as the parent nucleus. Here we have the nucleons, okay, protons, neutrons, okay. So the shaded part, you can take it as protons, or you can take it as neutrons, and these unshaded part can be taken as the neutrons, okay. If you consider this as the protons, okay, and this unshaded part, if you consider it as the neutrons. So I have not taken exactly number of protons and neutrons, just for an example we are considering. So this alpha particle, that is a helium nucleus, appears to be a subsystem of this parent nucleus. Okay, so when this alpha particle is pre-existing inside this parent nucleus, so it will experience a nuclear potential. Remember students this point. So let us consider, that is, this is the center of the nucleus. So from here to here, this is the radius of the nucleus. The radius of the nucleus is capital R. Okay, now, and from the center of the nucleus to the surface of this parent nucleus having a radius of R, this alpha particle will experience a potential, that is, will be nuclear potential. So for 0 to R, okay, where 0 is the center of the nucleus and R is the radius of the parent nucleus. So until here, so this will experience a potential, that is, alpha particle will experience a potential, that is what we call it as the nuclear potential. Okay, so beyond this, that is, when this is existing, that is, the alpha particle is existing as a substructure of the parent nucleus, so it will be it will be oscillating with a certain frequency within this radius, okay, to come out of this nuclear potential. So once this alpha particle just comes out of this parent nucleus and forms a daughter nucleus, so this is your daughter nucleus that is formed, which is having atomic number less by 2 units and mass number less by 4 units. So now this alpha particle, okay, which is having a radius of R dash, okay, so R dash is the radius of the alpha particle, and let us consider that is R is the radius of the daughter nucleus also, no problem, because only 4 protons have come out, so therefore the radius of this daughter nucleus and parent nucleus can be approximately taken as R, no problem. So now this particular alpha particle will experience a potential, but this potential is nothing but the Coulomb potential. Remember students, within, when the alpha particle is pre-existing, that is before the decay of the alpha particle, this alpha particle will be in the form of a, or it can be assumed to be in the form of a substructure of this parent nucleus. When this alpha particle comes out of this parent nucleus, that is, when it emits from the parent nucleus, it will experience a Coulomb potential within this parent nucleus before the emission. So this alpha particle will experience a nuclear potential. Okay, now at this particular situation, if you calculate, or if you try to calculate the Coulomb potential, which is given by the formula, So VC means it indicates that it is Coulomb potential. Okay, so the expression for the Coulomb potential or potential is given by 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught q1 q2 divided by r. So electrostatic force will be inversely proportional to r square, but potential will be inversely proportional to r. Okay, so if I take the charge q1 as the charge of the daughter nucleus which is emitted, so z, that is the daughter nucleus, will be having atomic number z by 2 units, that is, that means 2 protons will be coming out, so into charge of the proton, which is equal to the charge of the electron in magnitude. And q2 is nothing but, that is, it is also 2e, that is 2 protons are there, so e is nothing but the charge. And if I take r approximately as 10 to the power of minus 14 meter for uranium 92 235 nucleus, okay, so now, so uranium 238, okay, so I'll take this nucleus. Okay, if we calculate the Coulomb potential now, it is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, so z minus 2 into e into q2 is 2 times the charge of proton divided by, it is 10 to the power of minus 14. So Vc is equal to, here z is equal to 92 because we are studying the Coulomb potential or alpha decay for the uranium nucleus. So therefore z is equal to 92 in this case. So therefore I'll take that is 92 minus 2 into 2 into e into e square, that is 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19 the whole square. For accurate value you can take charge of electron as 1.602, no problem, divided by, sorry, here it is 9 into 10 power 9 because 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught value will be 9 into 10 power 9 divided by 10 to the power of minus 14 meter. So if I calculate by simplifying all these things, you'll get the potential or Coulomb potential approximately 26 mega electron volt. Okay, if you calculate the Coulomb potential for different samples of radioparent nucleus, that is for different radioactive nucleus, so the Coulomb potential will range between 25 to 30 mega electron volt. Okay, so for this uranium it will be that is approximately 26 mega electron volt. Okay, so for uranium the Coulomb potential is around 26 mega electron volt. So therefore for the alpha particle, when it is getting emitted, to come out of this potential, okay, so the kinetic energy, let us take it as T of alpha particle, it should be approximately or greater than 26 mega electron volt. Okay, I'll repeat once again. Now in order to escape from this potential or this Coulomb potential, the kinetic energy of alpha particle that is being emitted should be greater than that of the 26 mega electron volt. Why? Because for uranium nucleus we have found out that the potential or the Coulomb potential will be around 26 mega electron volt. So therefore approximately, if the alpha particle is having a kinetic energy, okay, greater than the 26 mega electron volt, so then easily the alpha particle can escape from this Coulomb potential. But the kinetic energy of alpha particle, which is being measured experimentally, okay, it is having the kinetic energy approximately from 4 mega electron volt to maximum of 10 mega electron volt or 11 mega electron volt. So the expected value is 26 mega electron volt, and the range of the alpha particle that you are getting to a maximum extent is around 10 mega electron volt. So still there is a difference of approximately 15 to 16 mega electron volt. There is a difference between this value and this value is around 16 mega electron volt, let us consider. But still there is an alpha particle emission. So how is this possible? So if you treat classically, then it is very difficult to explain the decay of the alpha particle. So therefore we have to look into the other aspect, that is nothing but the quantum mechanics properties, or we have to use the properties of quantum mechanics in order to explain the alpha decay process. So here Gammon did the same thing. So if we see this particular situation here, the kinetic energy that is needed theoretically is 26 mega electron volt. But experimentally, the measured electron, there is a kinetic energy maximum is 10 mega electron volt. So still there is a difference of 16 or 15 to 16 mega electron volt. So even also there is a difference or requirement of 16 mega electron volt. Okay, the alpha decay is taking place. It means that there is something assumption to be changed. Okay, so here we are looking classically. So therefore it has to be changed. That is the theoretical explanation has to be changed, not the classical mechanics. So we have to go for the quantum mechanics. So by using quantum mechanics, Gannon was able to explain the alpha decay successfully. Now let us look into it. Before going to it, so we shall draw a potential diagram. Okay, see here we can see the potential diagram for the nuclear potential and the Coulomb potential. So from the center of the nucleus to the surface of this daughter nucleus or the parent nucleus, so the radius is taken as r. Okay, and this r is the distance between the center of the nucleus to the center of the alpha particle. Okay, so I'll take this total distance as small r. Okay, there is a variation, and from this point or beyond this radius of the daughter nucleus or the parent nucleus, so we have the Coulomb's law, which is that is Coulomb potential, which is varying as 1 by r. Okay, now see, before the that is emission or before or within the radius of the nucleus, the maximum potential or the depth of the potential well will be around 26 mega electron volt. So from this point to this point, so this is nothing but the length of the potential, that is the Coulomb potential, and this will be the depth of the Coulomb potential. So now here we are having the kinetic energy of alpha particle within a range of 4 to 10 mega electron volts. So this is your kinetic energy of the emitted alpha particle. Okay, so now then see, we need just now we have discussed that is theoretically we need 26 mega electron volt, but here the kinetic energy of the alpha particle that is being emitted is having a maximum energy of 4 to 10 mega electron volt. So the but still, how is the alpha particle able to come out of this nucleus? So that can be explained by assuming the quantum mechanics. See, in case of quantum mechanics, we study the one of the important feature, that is the wave nature of material particles, right? So this is what we call it as a de Broglie hypothesis concept. Okay, in this concept, what we assume is whenever we have any particle which is in motion. Okay, so if this is moving with a certain velocity, then this is associated with the wave nature. So this is what we call it as the de Broglie waves, right? So the wave nature associated with any material particle in motion, so is nothing but known as the wave nature. So by using this wave nature, we are going to explain the decay of the alpha particle beyond this situation, that is beyond this potential. Now according to quantum mechanics, so we are using the wave nature property of the particle. So according to this, the probability of leaking an alpha particle through the barrier, through this barrier, is what we call it as the tunneling effect. So that is, the alpha particle that is within the nucleus must be present, that is, it must be present again and again at the barrier surface, such that if once there is a condition for escape or there is a condition for leakage, the alpha particle will come out of this potential, and this effect is what we call it as the tunneling effect, or it is also called as a quantum tunneling. That is, the probability of leakage of an alpha particle through the barrier is what we call it as the tunneling effect. Remember students, I have considered the wave nature of the that is the alpha particle or the wave nature of the particle. Okay, so this within this nucleus of radius r, the alpha particle will be bouncing back, that is, it is move, it will be moving to and fro motion within the nucleus, in order to, when it gets a condition for the ripe means ಹಣ್ಣಾಗುವಂಥದ್ದು. ಓಕೆ, ಸೊ ಇಟ್ ವೆನ್ ಇಟ್ ಗೆಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಕಂಡೀಷನ್ ಫಾರ್ ರೈಪಿಂಗ್, ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ವೆನ್ ಇಟ್ ಗೆಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಕಂಡೀಷನ್ ಟು ಕಮ್ ಔಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪೇರೆಂಟ್ ನ್ಯೂಕ್ಲಿಯಸ್, ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪನ್ ಸಡನ್ಲಿ ದಿಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಕಮ್ ಔಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ನ್ಯೂ ಪೊಟೆನ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ನ್ಯೂಕ್ಲಿಯಸ್, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ಸಫರಿಂಗ್ ದಿಸ್ ನ್ಯೂಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಪೊಟೆನ್ಷಿಯಲ್, ವೆನ್ ಇಟ್ ಕಮ್ಸ್ ಔಟ್ಸೈಡ್ ದ daughter nucleus or the parent nucleus forming an alpha particle. So this will be what is that, what we call it as the tunneling effect. So that is the passage or the leakage of this alpha particle through this potential or the barrier, okay, is what we call it as a tunneling effect, or it is also called as a quantum tunneling. Quantum tunneling effect. Okay, so this point is very important. Okay, students. So quantum tunneling can be defined as the probability of leaking an alpha particle, that is the leakage of the alpha particle through this potential barriers, is what we call it as the tunneling, or it is also called as the tunneling effect. So the alpha particle which is present inside the nucleus, again and again it will be striking the barrier surface, that is the boundary of the nucleus of the parent nucleus, until there is a condition for the penetration or the condition for the leakage is being satisfied. So therefore the alpha particle is in constant motion and bounces back and forth from the barrier walls, in which there is a certain probability of the leakage. So now let us consider, that is nu be the frequency of alpha particle colliding with the walls to escape from the nucleus. So nu is the frequency, that is frequency of alpha particle colliding with the walls of the parent nucleus to escape from the nucleus. And let P be the transmission probability. P is known as the transmission probability. Okay, and the relation between this frequency and this transmission probability with that of the decay constant lambda is given as lambda is equal to nu into P. Okay, so there is just mentioning of the condition, so therefore it is taken as lambda is equal to nu into P. Just there is no derivation for this, or we don't have any situation to derive this in the syllabus. Okay, now if V is the potential and T is the kinetic energy of the alpha particle emitted, okay, so this height, okay, will get you the height or the kinetic energy of the alpha particle. Okay, now since V is greater than T, so the where V is known as a potential height or the potential barrier, and T is called as the kinetic energy of alpha particle. So according to classical mechanics, the transmission probability is equal to zero. So this is according to classical physics or classical mechanics. According to classical mechanics, but in case of quantum mechanics, so there is a transmission probability is not equal to zero. That is, the alpha particle V is having certain probability such that it can escape from the potential of the nucleus. So according to quantum mechanics, the probability is not equal to zero. That is, the alpha particle will be definitely having certain certain probability to escape from this potential. So therefore we can show that there is a probability P can be shown as, that is transmission probability can be given by log of P to the base E is equal to 2 divided by H bar into integration R to R dash. So what do you mean by R dash? We know that. So once this the wave crosses this potential, okay, so this particular point where it is coming out of the Coulomb potential, so this point is taken as R dash. Okay, so from R to R dash, okay, so it is square root of 2 into m into V of x, that is potential with respect to distance, you can take it as R, no problem, into T, where V is the potential energy and T is the kinetic energy, into dx. So this is the expression for the probability or transmission probability according to quantum mechanics, and where m is nothing but the mass of alpha particle. Okay.